Thanks for joining us in our presentation of some fascinating research that we've been doing with Lincoln Gergar. I'm Jonathan Rickert from awarenessascending.com. And thank you, Lincoln, for participating in this. And we've got some really fascinating things to share.
Yeah, thank you, Jonathan. I appreciate this opportunity you have given me to display what the higher self channeling can do in a computer medium, in a brain measurement area. And then also I appreciate the opportunity to show you more of my own experiences and maybe talk about, you know, parts of my own life and how I have grown as a meditator and also as just a human being having this experience.
Yeah. Well, I was fascinated when we first met. I listened to a channeling that you did. And then afterward, we spoke for a little bit. And I came in to you with a kind of skeptical mind and probing you with some questions about, is this person somebody who is experiencing true non-ordinary states of consciousness, or are we, I don't know, is it alter ego or is this a show or what's going on? And so my kind of scientific skeptical brain kicked in, and it was fascinating. Hearing you talk about your personal experiences was lighting up a lot for me, because I've been studying the contemplative neuroscience research for a little while. I've been studying researchers who study awakening, and what your experience of life is like is very consistent with that research and literature.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's real important to be skeptical, like have a healthy sense of skepticism, because, I mean, just in my own experience, I've been in the spiritual field for over 20 years, and you hear a lot of people making claims, you hear a lot of people presenting certain things, and it's very important to validate it external to what people are just sharing themselves. So, you know, for myself, I've never really been put to a test. I've never really had my brain measured. I've never done any of these exercises. So I was interested as well to see what was going on inside of me. I know from my personal experience that what I do is genuine for me. It's authentic for me. But to have, you know, a non-biased look at it, I think was also very fun and entertaining as well as informative.
Yeah. And one of the things that I think is really important in that is that when someone is experiencing a non-ordinary state of consciousness, that there will be physical correlates of that experience. Okay. We may be at a limit of what we can measure. So we can't measure everything because we're still learning what to even look at in some cases, but there is a good foundation of research that shows specific brain states. We'll get into that. What can be happening in the heart with a measurement of heart rate variability. We'll be getting into that. And so we got to see all that, which was really exciting and validating, you know, that, wow, actually this is real and that we're seeing it in real time. And so we're going to go through some of that research, and I'll try to be as simple as I can for those of you that don't have any background in this field. We have to use some physics language. We have to use some language from contemplative neuroscience, some language from psychophysiology to explain this in as articulate but as simple manner as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'll do my best to share what I was experiencing at the time of these different measurements. We did three different periods of measurement. Yeah. So all three I had brain caps on, but two I had, we were measuring different things in two of them. Mm-hmm. And it was really exciting for me to learn about all this. I was in the beginner's circle myself. I knew relatively nothing about any of this science. So as Jonathan will be sharing things with you, I'm sure I'll be learning new stuff as well while we're presenting this this presentation.
And I'd like to acknowledge this was a team effort. And so who you don't see up here is Mark Zimzak, who is from Sedona Quantum Consciousness Center here in Sedona, Arizona. You can find him at breathing.coach. Alex Sanchez of Central Florida Biofeedback. He consulted on this and helped us run a lot of these maps in way more detail. Dr. Jay Gunkelman, who is Alex's mentor and one of the foremost neuroscientists, looked at maybe more QEG maps than anyone on the planet, at least in the top, you know, 0.1% mm-hmm. of people, like, you know, close to part of a million different brains he's looked at. Mm-hmm. So
Yeah, and this has been a great experience for me. These are a great team of guys. They know their stuff, at least as, you know, far as I can tell from a non-scientific point of view. They've just treated me incredibly, you know, allowed me to stop meditating as I was getting, you know, headaches from different equipment, because it is, you know, a lot of pressure on your head at certain points. And we were doing these measurements. I mean, the first one was over 2 hours. So what you're going to see are just some small clips, but you know, by the time we set it all up and we talked about it and we did the actual experiments, it was a 2 hour period. So I appreciate all the time and all the energy they offered to this project and to myself personally. Yeah, they're a really great team of guys. And if anybody has the opportunity and has the interest, I do recommend trying some of this stuff for yourself, because it really opened my mind to a lot of new things.
So we should give a bit of a background on what we measured. And so you're seeing a projection right now of a raw EEG. So EEG is short for electroencephalogram. So we have 19 channels. So when Lincoln's wearing a cap, there's 19 electrodes all over the scalp, and they're measuring the electrical potentials. Most of the measurement is happening on the top layer of the brain, what's called the cortex. A little bit of it, we can measure the next layer deep to that, which is part of the limbic region, but specifically the cingulate cortex, which is kind of the interface between this topmost layer and the next layer deeper in the limbic brain. And that's important, as we'll get into in a little bit later, because there is a important brain structure called the default mode network. So I'll just like seed the, we'll be talking about in a little bit, but seed it right now. So all of these different squiggly lines up here is a composite of multiple frequencies that are coming out of each electrode. So what you always see multiple frequencies occurring in the brain, but there's usually a predominance of one or the other, especially when you're doing a state change or you're implementing some type of intervention. Okay. So all of these are the 19 channels that you're seeing, and they're all basically a composite of different frequencies. And we're looking at Hertz frequency, which is a Hertz defined as a cycle wavelength per second. Okay. And so I'll play a little bit of this video so you can see in real time what's going on. This is part of the analysis that we did with Jay Gunkelman. And what's going to be coming up here in just a moment is this thing that we found when Lincoln was just sitting still. So we said, okay, we need to get a baseline of Lincoln's brain. Lincoln as being Lincoln, the personality Lincoln in the human form, as you know, his identity of Lincoln, just sit there for 10 minutes and do nothing, basically.
Yep. Yeah. And so that's what I did. I just sat there and did nothing. So I wasn't meditating. I wasn't thinking about anything. I was just being in the present moment, trying not to give my attention really to anything. And they measured my brain, and they wanted to create a baseline so that they would have something to compare all the different activities I was doing to. So if you have a baseline, then you can compare that to the different states I was in, and then you can locate the differences. And then it essentially shows you what's happening in these different states of consciousness.
So this is pretty standard practice in neurofeedback, where you want to, usually in a neurofeedback context, someone comes into a clinic, a psychology clinic is an example, with some type of symptomology that's pathological, like ADHD as an example. And so the practitioner says exactly the same thing. We need to get a baseline with your eyes open and another one with your eyes closed. Usually it's a 5 to 10 minute recording. And then they take the mean frequencies of that entire time frame and create a map of the brain and see what may be excessive or what might be diminished within the brain relative to a normal population. Okay. And so usually in that context, and I don't know if we mentioned this before when we were talking, but usually in that context, if someone has symptomology, you're going to see in that baseline all kinds of anomalies and dysfunction occurring in different parts of the brain. You know, usually people who have ADHD have like what we call frontal slowing. So the frontal lobe is a little bit slower. So you would see that in this baseline recording. But what's so fascinating was we were just kind of waiting for Jay to, you know, move on, because we were like, okay, let's get to the good stuff, Jay. Jay pointed out this really interesting 7.81 hertz peak in Lincoln's brain when he's just sitting there. And that's significant. So I'm going to move it forward. Here he is analyzing. Okay. So right about here, let's see, he's going to identify these peaks. You can see these peaks here. Let's see if I got my time code. Yeah. So this peak right here is at 7.81 hertz. Okay. So why is that significant? Because this is essentially what the Schumann resonance is. And as we talked about this more, it seemed like Lincoln's resting state is completely in alignment with the baseline of the Earth's background frequency of 7.83 hertz. And so this background frequency exists all the time. All of life on the surface of the planet has evolved inside this frequency. And there are harmonics that exist above that. So you can double it and you get the first harmonic, and then you double it again. And you triple it, you get the second harmonic, and so on. So I have a little representation here of what that Schumann resonance, how it's created. Let me pull that up. So here's the Schumann. Here's how it's created. So basically what happens is you have the surface of the Earth and the lower ionosphere. And when lightning strikes happen in the atmosphere, they start resonating around the planet and they create this resonant 7.83 hertz. And we're initially we thought, or Jay thought, you were just getting drowsy.
Mm-hmm. No, but that's my natural state. Yeah, we recorded this middle of the day, maybe 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Yeah. And so I was full awake. I was just literally doing nothing. And as I do nothing, my thoughts become very quiet, even for many minutes of time, silent without any thought. There's no processing inside of myself. I'm essentially just really doing nothing. And so I think that when I'm in that state, I just naturally vibrationally align with my environment. Mm. And if there's no objects or no people or no interactions inviting me into expression with them, I'm just going to more or less vibrate in harmony with the background. And so essentially in my relaxed state, I just naturally fall into a place of resonance with the Earth's electric frequency, because I'm not really creating anything from my own personal mind state.
Yeah.
And I've learned to live that way because I've been cultivating a Zen style of life since I was 18 years old. So for over 20 years, I've been practicing just being in an open state of awareness, allowing things to happen in my reality and not necessarily pursuing them. I've learned not to make judgments about things or have opinions about things. So I more or less just stay open and really feel myself integrating with the present moment in a more complete way than we normally experience. So when you pulled up this number and when Jay pointed out, it really, you know, made a lot of sense to me. That's the first idea that came into my mind, was this intuitive aha experience of recognizing that I'm actually showing evidence of living in harmony with nature, mm-hmm. of living in harmony with the planet itself on electromagnetic frequency range.
And normally we would not see this. We'd see much faster frequencies with someone just sitting there because they'd be thinking. Mm-hmm. So when they're thinking, you would see faster frequencies in the beta range, which pretty much didn't exist. So the assumption that Jay made was that you were getting drowsy because mm-hmm. as your frequency starts slowing down, that's when drowsiness occurs and eventually to sleep.
Yeah. And so my frequency was at 7.81 hertz in that spike. What would you expect to see for someone who has a normal functioning brain, normal daily activities?
Yeah, we would probably see a lot of what's called beta 3,
okay.
which is kind of what happens when you start self-referencing a lot, you're thinking a lot. Self-referencing, we'll explain that in a little bit here when we talk more about the default bone network, but just thinking mind or busy mind, or, you know, you're flitting from the next thing. There's no real focus to engage with, you know, you're not like doing anything that you're absorbed in. So that's when these frequencies start to appear.
Yeah. So what kind of number range would beta 3 be?
Yeah. So beta 3 is in this 25 to 35 hertz range.
Okay.
Okay.
And maybe you can give a background for the different ranges. I know there's like beta, alpha, theta, and delta.
Yeah.
Just give people a number range so that they can place where I'm at in particular and how it is more of a meditative awareness state, like a present moment mindfulness state.
Yeah. So delta being the some of the slowest frequencies in the brain run from about 0.5 to 4 hertz. And predominantly those happen when people are in deep restful sleep, which is very important. Nowadays, less people are doing that. And so what happens if you are not fully rested or not getting enough of that, it starts exhibiting itself throughout the day.
Mm.
And you see a lot of delta startup arising. And that can equate to, as a subjective experience, kind of brain fog, mm-hmm. if you will, or just not being sharp and clear and present. So directly above that, a little bit faster, is the theta range. And so that's running from 4 to 8 hertz. And so this 7.81, 7.83 is very close to the threshold of alpha, where mm-hmm. alpha comes into play. And there's a well-known neurofeedback protocol system called alpha theta training, where your brain is taken, you're taken down to alpha because most people are up in the beta range, and then drop down just in the higher portion of theta, right around where you are, and then brought back into alpha again, and then back down into theta. And that process helps unearth conditioning and trauma from earlier on that may be contributing to something like addiction.
Interesting.
And
so that process creates like a psychological healing experience. So when you bring yourself into those high theta ranges around like 8 hertz, 7.5 hertz, you find yourself integrating like a healing state and like
yes.
a karmic cleansing, like past experience purification.
Yes. So it's an opportunity for a subconscious trauma to come into awareness, into a rational kind of conscious awareness where it was buried before, and maybe driving a lot of behavior that you didn't want, that now you can come into contact with it and remove the emotional charge behind the memory. So you're not erasing the memory, you're just removing the charge that is having an unconscious effect in your life.
It's interesting you explain it like that, because that is essentially what was happening, what I was trying to experience just by living in the moment in this Zen style of presence. Because the idea of Zen is you want to live in the present moment and not be referencing the past, but more or less be so connected into life that you're in this automatic flow state.
Mm-hmm.
So just by being in this lower hertz range, I think as a byproduct is we remove that conditioning. We don't just react and respond to the situations mm-hmm. from these subconscious patterns. Instead, we are able to stay more present because those past conditionings have been lifted up and healed. And during my own life, when I was practicing living in awareness, I would witness the different parts of myself coming up. You know, something would happen in the environment, I'd see someone and it would create an idea inside of me. Mm. Not necessarily, you know, a difficult trauma from my past, but any form of judgment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd have an emotional response and an intellectual response to someone that I'm seeing. And I learned how to essentially uncondition that by just staying in awareness. So I never judged it, never did psychotherapy, I never needed to analyze it, because in my reality, I just wanted everything to be replaced with a present moment state of consciousness. And it looks like naturally my brain settled into those frequencies where that just happens as an automatic experience in an ongoing way.
Yeah, what you're describing regarding conditioning is something that's referenced a lot in the awakening literature. And people are transitioning into awakening all the time, but you cannot remove immediately the conditioning over a lifetime or maybe even longer than that. So there is a sort of a long tail effect of deconditioning that starts to happen as a result. If you continue to choose to be in awakening, because that can be a choice as well. You can choose not to be in awakening anymore. But as this long tail starts to play out and you decondition, then you will see you not only where your subjective experience change, but this for me is an indicator that you've been there for a while. Mm-hmm. Like there's as many years of deconditioning that's happened.
Yeah, it's been over 20 years. And even when I was younger, like a 13, 14 year old boy, I had knowledge of human psychology just innately. I just knew how to problem solve within myself. I knew how to problem solve with other people. So I think in my own life, I had a natural disposition towards conflict resolution and psychological healing, you know, psychological peace. And then I became more consciously aware of that and consciously interested in that when I began my spiritual journey at the age of 18. Mm. So yeah, for over 20 years, I've been doing this and I really dedicated my life to it to such an extent that I removed everything else that wasn't interesting to me, which included friends and social activities. So my whole life became about spiritual growth and spiritual progress, in addition to, you know, earning an income and being able to, you know, afford the normal things in life, like a place to live. So my whole day was essentially structured around those things. So I think some people, you know, they'll meditate in the morning, but then they'll forget that state during the 18 hours of their day. Mm-hmm. When I was in college, I realized, and some other teachers would mention, that you really have to make your spiritual practice a constant thing if you want to achieve that goal. And I see that with anything in our life. If we have a really important goal, we need to make it a priority in our life and not just something that we do occasionally. And so for myself, I made enlightenment a priority in my life, the most important priority. And I found myself restructuring how I ate, how I exercised, how I spent my time, how I socialized, who I spent time with. Even my romantic relationships all had spirituality as a cornerstone in our experience together. So really this process of awakening was the crux and the center of everything I did. So for anyone who's interested in purification themselves, you know, Jonathan said that it can take a lot of time to go through this. I think it's not necessarily, I think we don't have to think of it as how many years it's going to take, but rather how much time am I going to put into it? Mm-hmm. So I put in every minute of the day as best I could, and not in an obsessive way. It never caused me stress and suffering. It was something I looked forward to. Mm-hmm. I wanted to come home from class or come home from work and be able to sit and meditate and explore within myself. I wanted to be able to eat well because I benefited from that for all parts of my life. So I cultivated a higher vibrational way of living with food choices and exercises, and then also, of course, with my spiritual practices. Yeah, so I wouldn't get the idea that it's going to take 20 years to get enlightened or 50 years to get enlightened. I never put those limitations on myself. What was more important is that every moment I'm using my mind in a way that helps to create progress for my goals. So to think about a limited idea, like how much time it's going to take, that puts me in a stress state or makes me feel less than inspired. So why would I even concern myself with something I don't know that I can only hypothesize about?
And if you're not in a state of persistent awakening, that does seem like a chore, like it's work to do. But when you're experiencing persistent awakening, it's fun, like you mentioned, to do. You're like enjoying the experience, and that's part of the experience to do it. I think it's also worth noting that you have managed to remain functional in the modern world, which is not usually how it happens. So usually this is a monastic experience where someone is isolated constantly. They don't have to work. They don't have to have relations. In fact, they do things to remove themselves from 3D world so that they can focus on this only. So, and that's, I think, really important right now is to integrate both of those things.
Yeah, I totally agree. I considered going to a monastery after I graduated college, but it never felt right intuitively. And part of my own education emphasized taking responsibility for how you create your reality. Mm. And so I took responsibility for earning my own income and for paying my own way, for paying for my rent and paying for my home and my transportation and everything that I wanted in my life, I knew that I had to create it. I didn't want to put that onto someone else and make their way of living a burden to them, or my way of living a burden to them. So for me, I did structure my lifestyle in a way that integrated the spiritual practices, but then my work and my service or my dharma was just my daily occupations. So I was a photographer for a long period of time, for about 5.5 years, and I had a company making websites and doing online advertising for people. And then I began this work channeling online and offering free YouTube videos and personal consultation. And these aspects of the business I did myself. I did all the recording and all the editing and all the promotion, all the marketing material and all the sales. I took it all upon myself, and it just happened naturally. And also I was doing things I enjoyed. So I enjoyed these aspects of learning more and challenging myself. And I think it integrated a natural harmony. Work was never a struggle for me because I always looked forward to becoming better at whatever I was doing. My relationships were fun and enjoyable. And even while they were challenging, I looked forward to learning and cultivating myself in a better way. So just my way of framing everything in my life was really towards progress and wanting to introduce myself to new experiences that brought out better things in me.
So I think I left off at the threshold of theta and alpha. Yeah. So I should pick that up before we keep moving forward with the science here. So alpha range runs from 8 to 12 Hertz. And this is a very important range you're going to see here as we move into Lincoln's state of open awareness. Alpha can be broken into alpha 1 and alpha 2, 8 to 10 hertz. So when you have a predominance of 8 to 10 hertz in the brain, there is almost zero or there is no thinking at all. Okay, it is the kind of quintessential meditation state or stereotypical, I should say, you know, that there is really no thought happening at all. Or it's a blip on the radar, but you're basically absorbed in presence. And as you raise the frequency up between 10 and 12 hertz and go into what's called alpha 2, thoughts are occurring, but they're occurring in the background, not in the foreground. You're not wrapped up and identified with the thought. It's not who you are. So you can recognize the thinking is happening, but it's kind of happening around you. You have the choice to engage with it or not engage with it. And that's important.
Okay. And alpha 2 is 10 hertz on up to
10 to 12. 12. Yeah. And so in this alpha theta training I was referencing before, the significance is, okay, you go into theta where you're accessing subconscious. And so if there are memories in there that are traumatic, you will start to basically experience them. And as you bring, so then you transition up into alpha where you're able to think, but you're thinking in a calm way and you're assessing and rationalizing what you just experienced. And this is that process of going back and forth that allows one to untangle themselves from the emotional charge and basically integrate whatever that trauma was and integrate the past. Mm-hmm. That makes sense. So going from 12 hertz all the way up to 35 hertz, this is the beta range. And that's broken into three bands. Beta 1 is actually very healthy to be existing in, 12 to, I'm going to say 15. I'm sketchy on exactly where the upper end of that is. But this is sensory motor rhythm. This is a great place to be kind of thinking and engaged, learning, but without excess, without anxiety, without hyper-focusing and inefficient way of operating the body. So then you have the beta 2 range, and the beta 2 range is kind of variable, as is not so interesting. Beta 3 is where you see a lot of stress happening, mm-hmm. Okay? And so 25 to 35 hertz is that beta 3 range. So chronic stress, sympathetic activation, you see more incoherence. Incoherence is when you have different areas of the brain exhibiting beta, but they're not phase locked. They're not the waveform
communicating with each other.
Yes, mm-hmm. Exactly. And that is another metric that we look at, is coherence to incoherence. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so we'll be talking about that in a moment. And then above that, from 35, usually kind of you see these peaks in 40, going all the way up to about 120 is gamma. And gamma has been a really interesting, relatively new area of research where we see a lot of exciting things start to happen. This is where flow states are occurring. This is where downloads like epiphanies and aha moments start happening. And it's also where we see Tibetan meditators or loving kindness meditators have a lot of gamma, a lot of resting gamma when they're not even meditating. And so my suspicion, when you were going to be doing the spiritual heart type meditations and channeling with this type of energy, is that we would see some gamma at play. And part of the reason why it's relatively recent in study is because back in the day when the first neurofeedback systems and the first EEG systems were around, they weren't able to measure the gamma. They didn't even know what to look at, you know? So you kind of need, you may even see these frequencies happening, but you have no way to correlate it to any state experience or psychological state. So you, it looks just like junk DNA is an example, right? It's kind of that metaphor. It's like, we don't know what it is. It's just blah. But then when you start measuring people that are performing at a very high level and you see the gamma, you go, oh, okay, we're paying attention now. And so a lot of consumer devices are coming out to train this brain state, either through neurofeedback or actual entrainment where there's lights pulsing or magnetic fields or infrared light and these kinds of things. So that's the general frequency range that you see in the heart that we measure. And that explain it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was great.
Okay. All right. So I want to, we're going to move on to looking at open awareness, that first state that you went into. So maybe you can explain what you were experiencing there while I pull up this this map here, because we're going to look at Alex's map.
Okay, so this is just in the beginning when I started and I was just being present with my surroundings.
Yes.
I wasn't formally meditating, but I was just in that experience of mindfulness and really not, again, not doing anything, but trying to be just peacefully present, also feeling this quality of open space more. Mm-hmm. So in my experience, our awareness is essentially emptiness. It's a feeling of empty, open space, and our awareness doesn't really move. So sounds move and you can hear the sounds and you can actually feel the sound energy move, at least I can. Also light, you know, you can see the light and you can feel the light. So many people who are sensitive to color or who are empathic, you notice when you see a different color, you feel a different emotion. Mm. So even inside our emotional body, there's still movement, but all of that is housed within this emptiness, which is our state of awareness. So for me, an awareness-based meditation is really knowing yourself as this container of perception and recognizing the stillness, the silence, and the empty qualities of this perception.
Do you think that that is the Zen state, that is something that you cultivated with this type of meditation?
For myself, yeah. And I know we're going to talk about this a little later when we look at some of the brain scans, comparing my understanding of Zen and my experience of Zen to some other Zen practitioners who are measured. Because my experience of Zen is based upon a certain number of teachers of Zen, the earliest ones who are actually part of the Chan system, because Zen first began in China. So in Japan, it was called Zen. In China, it was called Chan. But it's really the similar system. It's all the basic same, or the same basic principles. So for myself, I was applying that state of empty, open awareness and no thought, that no mind state, in every moment as best I can. I was trying to live in a relaxed state. One of my favorite teachings is a book called, it's Sosan's Song, or it's translated as The Book of Nothing. And essentially he talks about these different states of mind and how even the smallest amount of personal effort creates a dualistic expression and it starts to alter that purity of our mind. So I was trying to stay in this pure mind state, and that's what I understood Zen to point towards. So how could I be without any movement, without any judgment, without any response to life, and really just allow for this flow state while I felt myself and knew myself as silent, empty, open awareness? Mm. And so that's what's going to show up in these different diagrams.
Yeah. And what you are describing as a subjective experience is what I was mentioning when you see a lot of alpha, right? When you see a lot of alpha in the brain. So this is a QEEG. So this is a visual representation of the frequencies overlaid onto the different areas of Lincoln's head. Okay. So this little point up here is the nose, obviously, if you can figure that out yet. And so I'm going to just scroll to, okay, empty space. So this, I'm going to circle, this is delta, this is theta, this is alpha, beta one, beta two, and gamma. And so if it's dark in color, like blue and black, that means very little amplitude or very little frequency very little amplitude in that frequency. Okay. But where you see this purple, he's exhibiting a ton of alpha, Okay. And so that's pretty much present. Doesn't matter if he's doing a spiritual heart meditation here. You see the alpha peaking in the back. If he's doing spiritual heart, root and crown, you see the alpha peaking in the back. And spiritual heart, crown and upper chakra, which we'll talk about a little bit later. So all of these, he's got a high level of alpha. And the other metric that we want to, we want to identify is coherence. So we talked about coherence versus incoherence. And so that was another major feature that we saw with your brain, was that there was a lot of coherent, phase locked waveforms that were synchronized together. And so that's what this, all of this pink and red that you see is tons of coherence in these specific areas. So this is just baseline right here. There's a ton of coherence. And when you're doing the spiritual root and crown and the third eye meditation, especially, you have a lot of coherence. And so that seems to correlate, you know, it seems to be relatively important for what you're experiencing.
Yeah. And when you're doing a third eye exercise, when your third eye starts to open, it really does require you to be integrated in the experience. Mm. You can't drift out into a tired state, or you can't drift into the physical reality perception. So there really is a strong experience of focused awareness. Mm. And I think that brings that alpha into the theta, because there's a strong focusing quality while you're in that non-physical energetic universe.
Does that require effort, more effort to be in that state than some of these others?
Yeah, different than the spiritual heart. So in the spiritual heart, there's more of a quality of letting go. You still have to be present enough and focused enough, but in a very relaxed way. So to enter into the spiritual heart, essentially you're forgetting more of your personal self, and you're allowing yourself to expand into the backdrop of reality, into this open space that fills everything and the original light that's creating everything. So you're actually moving backwards in the dimensions. So if we look at our reality, it's like we're stacking dimensions on top of each other. Mm. So the physical reality is what we perceive, and it's the densest vibration. And then more subtle than that is the emotional reality. And that relates to our dreaming mind, our subconscious mind. So it probably correlates more to theta experiences, I would imagine. But again, I don't know the science of this. Then deeper than that is our causal body, with is that deeper part of our intelligence, that mental body. And that might even correlate to delta, but I don't know. And then beyond that is just pure consciousness. So the backdrop is really the state of pure consciousness. And to get to the spiritual heart, you have to drop into that. So you really go deeper into that selfless state, or that no self state. Whereas when we're having this third eye experience, there's more of a feeling of self. Mm-hmm. It's not selfing in terms of thinking about yourself or trying to perform it. You're still surrendering into just being, but there is a tangible feeling that there's more happening, like your consciousness is more engaged. So for anyone who's had third eye awakenings, you're without thought, and it feels like that part of your perception, that third eye, is kind of pulling you in. It's drawing you into the experience. And it feels more personal, like more of a personal self than the spiritual heart experience does, which feels more like a universal self that you're expanding into.
So you're aware of yourself witnessing whatever that you're seeing.
I'm aware of myself witnessing in all of those states, except when I lose this perception of being an individual. Okay. So if I go fully into that spiritual heart state, then I'll lose awareness of myself. All aspects of self-reflecting will vanish. Now, that didn't happen in our meditation that we did. That for me is a rare experience, and it happens by grace. It's nothing that I can try to replicate, because any effort to try to replicate it is yourself
going
stepping
the opposite direction.
Yeah. So a lot of the work that I do, it teaches people how to surrender that personal will and that personal effort to connect more to a universal will. So we become the vehicle of this universal consciousness in many ways. And if that universal consciousness wishes to give us an experience, then it's going to happen. And as we watch the videos, you'll notice as I'm talking about the experience that's happening when I'm in this open state of awareness, is different things arise automatically. I had three rounds of a Kundalini awakening at the beginning of the meditation. I had the third eye appear and this blue, it's like a purple blue light appear. And I saw that as my third eye started to appear. That lasted for a period of time. And then the spiritual heart started to illuminate. So all of those things happened without me doing any practice, without me trying to initiate anything, without me even having a goal or a plan for anything to occur while we're doing this measurement. Mm-hmm. For me, it was, I'm just going to do the meditation, trust in the will of God, and just allow to happen or allow to be what's going to happen, mm-hmm. just knowing it's all in perfect alignment. So that's why I think you also see these lower brainwave states, because like even that alpha state, alpha coherence, because there's no personal self doing a practice. Mm-hmm. I'm not counting breaths. I'm not controlling my breathing. I'm not doing any mantra work. I'm really just being in a state of presence with my reality and following the guidelines of what the scientists want me to do. They say, meditate, you meditate. They say, jump, you say, how high?
So the next thing to talk about is the default mode network. So we're going to look at the DMN right here. And this is an fMRI of...
Okay, so what's an fMRI and what's the default mode network?
So the default mode network. So this is a four-node network in the brain. So these are neural networks that are all wired together. The biggest one in the back here is an area that we focus on a lot with something called neuromeditation. And we're going to talk about neuromeditation directly after this. And so here's the medial prefrontal cortex. Then you have the precuneus or the posterior cingulate. And then on the sides here is the angular gyrus. And so why is this significant? Well, what has been found in studying this more often is so initially how it was discovered was when neuroscientists would ask people to do something, a task, they would notice that these nodal networks would go quiet. They would start exhibiting alpha. So there'd be less activity here. But when they were being idle, they would see an increase in frequency in the beta range. Okay. And so as contemplative neuroscience branched out and started studying channelers and meditators, they realized that the same thing was happening when people will go into a meditation state. So you would see alpha happening here, and that would correlate with the subjective experience of no self. Mm. Okay. And so what developed out of this was an understanding of what's called self-referential thought, or what we call selfing. And so self-referential thought is any thought that relates to your personality. And this doesn't have to be like some type of affirmation, you know, like I am beautiful or I'm terrible. You know, it's just like more, we have these all the time. I need to go to the grocery store and get some ghee and I need to get some oatmeal. And, or I'm thinking about my wife. And so all of these are referencing to self. They're like little lines that kind of connect your identity to the world outside of you. So there are other experiences that make this go quiet as well. Psychedelics is a big one, which is why it's now being explored so much in psychotherapy. So psychedelics, plant medicine, meditation, if it's done right, and tasking. So when you're absorbed in a task, this also goes quiet. So we can see this in a way as a brain structure of your ego or your identity.
Mm-hmm. So these areas light up with alpha when you forget yourself and you're living moment to moment, whether in a task or in meditation.
Yes. Yeah,
exactly. And usually you have no self-referencing thought. So your thought is about the task you're doing, or you're not having any thought.
Yeah, well, it depends on where you are, alpha one or alpha two. Okay. So if you're in alpha two, you can have thoughts about things that are not referencing self. Mm-hmm. But if you're in alpha one, you're probably not having any thought at all.
Okay, so you're really in the moment. You're very connected to what you're doing.
Yeah, exactly. And so we're going to next look at what's called neuromeditation. So neuromeditation is a neurofeedback technique that I use to teach people how to meditate. Two things, really. One is answering the question, am I doing it right or not doing it right? And you can fairly quickly get feedback. Yes, that's the state change. Yes, that's the feeling. That's where the direction that you're going to train.
Okay, so you're actually measuring the location of the brain that the meditation is trying to work on, and you're actually getting actual numbers that are showing you how well the meditator is performing.
Yes. And so I can see that objectively. What we're looking at back here is that back node, that big back node, the procuneus, which is the biggest portion of the default mode network. So what we're asking the brain to do is exhibit alpha in that area. And so we're seeing that in real time. But for someone wearing the cap, they're feeling, so they'll get feedback in the form of sound or music. It's like kind of ambient meditation music. When you hear that feedback, you now rationally know, your conscious mind is aware, you just did the right thing to go in this direction of meditation. When the feedback disappears, it's usually because of mind wandering, which happens to everybody. So you get this very clear sense, a bookmark, if you will, of when you're meditating, when you're not. The other thing that it does is it significantly accelerates the ability to drop into that state. So what might normally take 5 or 6 months of daily practice can happen in 5 or 6 weeks. And so, of course, this is something like doing it once a week for an hour, but in between all those days, they're back at their home practicing some basic, you know, body awareness type of meditation stuff to reinforce what was just learned. Mm-hmm. And this significantly accelerates the process. So I wanted to throw Lincoln onto this equipment because I want to see it. Oh, okay. Well, is what the machine training is similar to what he's experiencing with Zen, because this is based on 40,000 hours Zen meditators. Okay. And the other thing I wanted to see was, well, if I start making it more difficult, can Lincoln actually keep up? Which was fun to kind of do, like give him a little weight training for his brain. So
the way you make it more difficult is to watch the numbers I'm creating and then raise the threshold, raise the bar. So if I drop below those good numbers, then the music, the biofeedback music, or the feedback music turns off.
Yes.
And so he's constantly making it more challenging. So as I'm getting essentially higher brainwave readings, like better numbers, he's trying to raise the bar to keep getting me higher and higher and to see how high I can go.
Yes, right.
So it's like a high jumper in the Olympics.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. As you compete further than the, you know, you're now competing against higher, you know, more excelled people. And so now the bar keeps getting higher.
I like to think I'm just competing against myself.
Yes. So I'll just hit play here. And so there's another feature of this that is significant, and it relates back to your particular type of Zen training relative to what normally happens. So in the back here, this area, so we're looking right now at delta, okay? Now we're saying delta, let me rewind this a bit. I'll pause it. Okay, delta down. So we want less delta frequencies back there. That's put in here because when someone usually experiences more delta, they become tired. So we want someone to become aware when they're starting to fall asleep instead of meditating, okay? Mm-hmm. Because they're two different things. So that's what the delta is. The alpha is something we already talked about. So this is probably where you should come in and explain what was going on.
Okay, yes. So as I was doing this Zen meditation, I'm just being in a state of empty, open presence and essentially being in that no mind state as I understand it to be. So I'm feeling myself space into this present moment. I'm feeling myself more connected to the vibration of my surroundings. My mind is silent. I'm not having any thought. And I'm also not trying to do anything. Now, in my experience, as I shared with Jonathan, this is the first time I did it. I had no practice. And so I'm hearing the music, and the music for this one wasn't even playing because I wasn't actually meeting the requirements of the software. So like I'm doing Zen and my mind's kind of getting a little frustrated because I can't make the music play. And I'm like, I'm doing Zen, it should be happening. And at some point, my mind just like, you know what, forget it. Like, I don't even care about this machine and these numbers. I'm just doing what I think is Zen. And what we saw is the numbers I was creating were different than what the program was looking for, but they're actually very significant because it showed I was producing very high amounts of delta in this part of my brain. Now, my understanding of Zen is what I've described. It's being in that open state of presence, but monastic Zen is very different, right? Monastic Zen emphasizes being in physical reality and essentially holding your presence. Mm. And it's very disciplined. So if you waver in your presence at all, the Roshi, the Zen master, he'll actually slap you with a bamboo reed and he'll wake you up. So in this style of Zen, you don't want to go into these deeper states of near sleep or delta. You actually want to be more alpha based and more physically present without thought. Now, as Jonathan told me, like going to the Zen state, I was actually exhibiting more delta. I was going deeper, but I wasn't falling asleep. So my brain was producing what usually happens in a sleep state while I was completely awake and present and functional.
Yeah. And you were qualifying the difference as more delta, more space, sense of space, less delta, more monastic Zen, almost a more congealed sense.
Yeah, a feeling of a personal self. And in that delta state, you're more selfless because you now become merged with your surroundings. Essentially, it's like what happens in channeling, except in channeling, there's a very strong direct connection to something greater than just your environment here. Like in that Zen awareness state, it's really about becoming one with the all that is present with you. So it's about merging into your environment. So for me, there's less of a feeling of a personal self and more of a feeling like I'm this space and everything's just moving and appearing inside of me. So that's my experience as you get into these deeper states of no mind, no self. And that just happened naturally as I was practicing meditation.
Yeah, it was so illuminating hearing that, because the person who programmed this has a monastic Zen background. So it would make sense that this was what they were trying to achieve by creating this protocol. And I didn't know the history. I didn't know the deep history behind it.
Yeah. It was interesting. I had earlier in my life, I went to a channel and she channeled a being who works with these angels. And I got a message one time, one of these group sessions, and the angelic being said that I was making my spiritual practice and my Zen practice too idea-based, too ideological. And so for me, I was holding on to the concepts of what Zen should be. So simplicity, minimalism, purity. Essentially, when I was just about 22 years old, I was really focused on trying to be Zen rather than just being what is. And I think that might relate to this, you know, monastic style of Zen, where you do your rituals, you sweep the floor, you're supposed to do all of these routines in an ideal way. And I think that can build up a sense of a self and a sense of identifying with the ritual and the practices of Zen. And then that wouldn't allow you to really forget yourself and be more part of the present moment.
And it's also a task. A lot of the work done in a monastery is, okay, you're sweeping the floor, you're cleaning the latrine, you're baking the bread, you're doing a task, which is a facilitation tool for taking the default mode network offline. But you cannot go into space because you have to maintain presence in order to complete the task.
Yeah. And for me, I did a lot of tasks. I spent a lot of the hours of my day working. I had my own companies. I had my own job. I was in relationship. I was exercising. So I was very involved in tasks in my life. But the core of my spiritual practice and how I applied my spiritual practice when doing those tasks was to try to perform them in a type of selfless way. In the experience of you're flowing with the universe, there's a greater intelligence than your own personal mind guiding you while you're performing these things. So what I found throughout my journey, even in college, it began because I first learned about Zen when I was 18. So I was just about to go to college, is I was channeling papers and I would just go through the examinations and I wouldn't pause and I wouldn't self-reflect. I would just read the question and immediately I'd know the answer without having to have any sound in my thoughts. And so I was already living in this flow state because I was applying Zen that way. And I was trying to integrate that in every moment. Because for myself, I didn't desire to graduate college, but I knew I was going to, I knew I should, but I didn't struggle intellectually with trying to achieve something in university. For me, it was, no, I want to achieve something in my spiritual growth, and everything else is secondary on this journey. So I'll go through university. I know its value, but I'm not going to emphasize that in my personal reality. I'm going to emphasize the cultivation of myself.
So we're going to jump ahead a little bit and we're going to get into looking at heart rate variability and some of the other biofeedback. So biofeedback is measurements and feedback that come from the body, not from the brain. Okay, so we're really looking at the autonomic nervous system, which is named that because the processes are involuntary. So most people, or it's believed, that you cannot control things like your heart rate or your skin temperature or the skin sweat that you might be experiencing. So we looked at skin sweat from the palms. We looked at heart rate variability, which I'll talk about in a second, and respiration rate. We kind of looked, and also Mark was gathering information about CO2 output when you're exhaling, kind of gathering that too, which refers back to heart rate variability, because your breathing and your heart rate variability are interlinked. So are emotions. And so it's pretty well known that when you breathe at specific rates, you can increase heart coherence, which is a kind of minimal effort, ideal idle state to be in. You can only get so far with that, with improving that with breathing. There's other things you can do. Anything that activates the vagus nerve, which is the main nerve of the parasympathetic or rest and digest system, that will also improve heart rate variability. So there's a lot of lifestyle and behavioral practices a person can do to strengthen this. It's really important generally that we do this for physical health. And it, really no physical healing can occur unless the vagus nerve is active and alive and you're connecting with it and you're doing things to make it light up. So, but what heart math has shown is that emotions play an even greater role in your heart rate variability. And when you are practicing intentional emoting and you're practicing positive emotion, you can get massive spikes in your heart rate variability that you simply cannot get when you're changing your breathing or doing any of these other vagal interventions. So we're sitting here, this is like in our first session with Lincoln, and we've got him hooked up and he's talking, and you can see right here, this is what we call the frequency spectrum of heart rate variability. So I'll try to explain this simply. This area of green is where coherence happens. This is sort of the overlap between the sympathetic and the parasympathetic systems. And you want to have a good balance between the two. And a lot of people think that sympathetic nervous system, that's somehow bad. We don't want this to be turned on because this happens a lot when we're stressed. But the truth is we need it to be active and working for us. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to jump out of the way if a car was about to hit us. So we need to be able to have explosive action when it's necessary to take care of our physical body is usually the thing, you know, the idea of the tiger attacking you in the cave kind of thing, right? But what happens with stress is that it's kind of chronically activated on a low level, and then it creates a whole bunch of different dysfunctions afterwards. But when you get this point one, okay, so I'm gonna pause it right here because this is the juicy part. So when you start to see this 0.1 hertz spike right here, that is showing good heart coherence. And that's something that everyone should be practicing to create just as an idle state. And so Lincoln is here talking and we can see this peak happening. Everything above this in what we call high frequency range, that is the vagal system, pretty much only the vagal system, okay? So Lincoln is talking, explaining what he's feeling what he's doing, and he's saying he's going to energize his nerve. So talk about this,
right? Yeah. So I was just having normal conversation before we even began the experiments, and I was noticing on the screen the bars were moving. And at one point I focused on my third eye, and that's when I started to see the bars move. And then I'm saying, look, I think I can move them, and I want to try to fill the whole screen and raise all the bars. So at this point, I'm now filling my whole body with energy. That's what it feels like to me. And I'm trying to essentially get the highest reading on all the different areas of this heart coherence chart. I didn't even know what the chart was measuring. I'm just trying to fill my body with energy.
this was an amazing moment. Mark and I are trying to focus when he's doing this. So this is the autonomic nervous system. And theoretically, that shouldn't be possible. I mean, we have anecdotal reports from yogis that can do kinds of things like this. But to redline all of the frequencies by just saying that you're going to do it and then stop doing it and then just say, okay, I'm stopping now. And to be able to do this on cue, that is a rare thing that a human can do. So that was very fun to see.
And I didn't really know what I was supposed to do. We were just talking and I see the bars moving and my mind kind of figured it out or guessed at it. And then I said, well, what happens if I charge my whole body up? And I saw them jump a little bit. And then I kept talking at the end. I'm like, oh, watch what I'm going to do. I'm going to try and fill them all up. So for me, it's just having your consciousness in your body. And I kind of explained that afterwards. It's for me, it's normal. Like, I know you don't usually see this with working with people, but everything that has happened in me and all these things we're going to be measuring, they're just byproducts of just having an authentic spiritual practice that in my mind was very fine tuned from the beginning. So on my own journey, it took me about 2.5 or 3.5 years to really understand what my goals were in spirituality and what these greatest teachers were talking about. It's like anything in life, you're going to find all these different teachers and all these teachings, and they're going to be pointing you in different places saying this is most important or that is most important. So it took me about 3.5 years to sort through these and understand what was I actually looking for. And then once I identified it, I kept finding the highest level teachers for me that kept repeating the same thing. So I identified it, saw repetition, and that reinforced it. And then I essentially cut out all learning and I just followed what I felt was the best based upon everything that I researched. And then in years that just continued. Channeling happened automatically. This ability to fill my body with energy happened automatically. The deep delta state happened automatically. So many of these things just were a natural cultivation of trying to live as this no mind state. And then of course, also doing the higher self channeling, which just happened automatically.
It's interesting to hear you use the word goals in a spiritual practice.
I think we can't avoid goals. I think we have an inaccuracy, and it's a little unfortunate in how we talk about spirituality coming from Buddhism, especially. Mm-hmm. In Buddhism, there's this emphasis on the no self as a negation or resistance to what's natural about the human experience. And my teachings of Zen saw those flaws in monastic Zen, and the teachers were even outspoken against that. And they said, no, we shouldn't have these strict conditions of how things should look. We should just strive for a natural experience. So in my own striving for a natural experience, I witnessed that the whole universe of form is driven by desire. And once you get rid of desire, you get rid of change. So even on an atomic level, these positive and negative attractions that atoms have are essentially forces of desire, and they're bringing things together to create new chemical compounds. Every conversation, the mating of the species, the planetary movements, every piece of form, even in the emotional dimension, with our desires for higher vibration, everything's moved by desire. And goal is just a formulation based upon our forward thinking ability as humans to identify what our desire is going to look like in the future. So for me, having goals is unavoidable in life. And anybody who tries to talk as if they don't have goals or desires, I feel is just confusing themselves with concepts. Because I think it's actually impossible to be in form without having desire or goals. Even your body has a goal to eat food, a goal to survive, a goal to wake up the following morning, a goal to go to sleep at that night. The whole structure of the universe is based upon even the goal of God consciousness, of God realization at the end of one's journey. So yeah, I'm very goal oriented, even in my physical experiences, very goal oriented. And that's what allows me to keep going in one direction and not to, I think, have a lot of these self-sabotage systems, you know, where we get mad at ourselves because my goal is more important than my own self evaluation. You know, so I don't have time to get mad at myself and judge myself. I want to learn and progress more than I want to indulge in my own thoughts about myself.
So this is another video. And by the way, all these videos that we're showing are on YouTube's, Lincoln's YouTube page. So you can see them there. And there is some dialogue happening in the background that's a bit different than what we're saying right now. This is a really neat tool that's in the same software. It's just a different window within the software. And you have a quadrant set up that is essentially showing real-time emotions. Really helpful for people that are a bit disembodied or and very cerebral to know, and also helpful for people who are relatively aware of their emotions, but not aware of the lower amplitude emotions, like the subtler ones that are happening underneath the surface, and to tune into that. And what's, I think, really interesting about how they can measure this is that they're looking not at the frequencies of the heart when we showed the frequency spectrum, but they're looking at the waveform. So this is another HeartMath technology that's been licensed by this company. And HeartMath has been able to 90% or so accuracy look at the waveform of someone's heart and determine their emotion, which is amazing, that the heart is expressing itself. And so when I say waveform, I'm talking about the morphology or the shape that the wave is making as it's in a frequency. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so Lincoln is playing, well, why don't you tell us what you're doing here?
So again, I'm just discovering this software. This was just after I filled up all the bars, and I'm watching how I can change the emotion I'm feeling inside myself, and that moves the orange dot on that screen. So I tell them in that moment, look, I'm going to make myself happy. Okay, I'm going to make myself peaceful. And I go back and forth, and the dot moves around the screen. So what I've discovered in myself, and at least I knew this the whole time, my own experience, that I can control my emotional state. I believe that even a good actor can do this. One who can, who's a true thespian, they can actually control their emotion and make it more believable. So for me, it's just conscious control over a part of our mind and our physiology that allows us to create vibration. So we learn how to generate it from our own conscious self. And I have a background in human psychology, and in human psychology, it's often taught that our emotions are unconscious reactions, that we learn them when we're little kids, and we're more or less stuck with them for the rest of our lives. And if you want to change it, you have to work really hard. And in most cases, it's not possible. Mm-hmm. And my experience is it is possible, but you have to know how to work with it. And the key is getting your awareness into the feeling of your emotion. And that's what a lot of these modern day self-help teachings are actually talking about. They're instructing people how to feel their emotions, how to get their consciousness, their creative self, into the vibration of emotional feeling, and then how to work with it. So I taught myself this my whole life. I've never been to a therapist. I've never read books or taken courses. Just by being in a Zen state of awareness, my goal, my desire was to silence any emotional activity I was having because I wanted to be empty without a self. Mm. And I took it to a level, not just of like the self-referencing thought, but actually the vibrational experience in my body and in my psyche. So I worked at that. Whenever I would notice emotion arising, even seeing happiness for something you desire or having a random thought, whatever it was, I would bring it back into a state of stillness. And so during my own journey, I learned how to sense where the different emotions were happening in my body. I learned how to locate them, how to sense the different feelings and frequencies of them. Just by being in awareness within my own experience, I taught myself what emotional energy is. And so I developed conscious control over my emotions by just being present with them, moving them to silence and understanding them essentially.
Mm-hmm. So one other point I should make here about this is there's two axes here. This axis represents arousal. So this this is a really helpful way to understand emotions, because what I've noticed in teaching people how to identify their emotions and then training this emotional, what you were just talking about, emotional regulation, is that arousal basically represents energy or just pure energy without quality to it. Okay. So you can be in a high energy state or a low energy state. You can be more sympathetic or more parasympathetic. This axis here represents valence. So valence is positive or negative emotion, roughly. So you can have low arousal, low valence emotions. And an example of that is depression or apathy. You can have high arousal, high valence emotions, and that is bliss or ecstasy. Okay. And so generally speaking, we're training ourselves to be over here in the positive valence category, not necessarily arousal. So that's the question. So as your energy level waxes and wanes throughout the day, you still want to have positive emotion as that you're traveling through that arousal range.
Yeah, it's important to have balance with all parts of our life. I think that's what allows for health to happen. Mm-hmm. If you are into exercise or physical health, if you exercise all the time and you overexercise and you don't sleep enough, you'll notice you get injured, you don't perform as well. You'll notice you're sore, you're tired, your brain doesn't function as well. So in almost all the areas of our life, this aspect of balance is really important. And when we looked at the charts after my readings, we were finding a balance between the happiness and the peace. Mm-hmm. Even while I was in the state of meditation, there was this oscillation naturally happening. And in my meditative states, I was in a no mind state. I was just being present. I wasn't trying to control anything. I wasn't trying to arouse energy in any way. Like in the earlier video where I made all the bars raise, I was trying to arouse my energy system. Trying to show something on the screen. But for the other practices, I turned off that personal self and I was just in a state of relaxed, open awareness. And it was really neat that we saw this organic type of balance happen as this dot move between happiness and peace and happiness and peace.
Yeah, you know, piggybacking off of that, there's been a few times when I've noticed, personally, okay, so most people never take any silent time of any significant length, days and days and days, like a silent retreat, for example, whether it's solo or you're going to a meditation retreat. And when you step out of this incessant thinking that happens normally, and you can be in more of a witness state watching your own emotionality, you start to see the conditioning that you've created as your emotional valence changes. And so that's another indicator here that you have processed and integrated and deconditioned a lot of heavier emotions that may be built up as a result of maybe incessant negative thinking about a particular topic. And if you stop thinking and you haven't deconditioned, the emotions will still arise and come through. They're not going to last forever, but they could be very intense. And so I noticed that when I was on a meditation retreat years ago, I was like, whoa, look at this. And here it is again. And it was almost like circadian in nature. It would almost happen at the same time every day, you know, going between three or four different moods, if you will.
That's interesting, because if you look at Chinese medicine, there's different organ energies and they appear in dominance at different times of day. Mm. And in Chinese medicine, every organ has an emotion or a few emotions associated with it. So it makes sense if you're just being in awareness and observing yourself, you'll notice your body's going through these biorhythms and you also have an emotional cycle that's related to these biological rhythms.
I wish I had known that back then. That would have been a fun thing to...
Yeah, you could look at it in a
different way. May have taken me out of the experience as I was trying to analyze it all.
Yeah, you look back after you're done, yeah.
Okay. What I want to look at next is... I want to look at and show where you're peaking this 0.1 hertz spike. Do you know what video next we see that in?
Well, in this video, I show both. So this is me exiting just a meditative experience. And I have a 0.1 hertz spike and a 0.2 hertz spike.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly how high you want to see it because those spikes were higher when I was doing the third eye seeing. Even now you can see there's one climbing and that's about 0.15 hertz.
Yeah, I'm going to pause right here because you can see with the spike that's happening, the emotion he's experiencing is elated.
Yeah, I'm in the highest emotion. So when you're up in that right-hand corner, that's the strongest happiness. And then you also see the smoothness at the bottom of maximum smoothness. So that's also evidence of this high emotion. And you can see the bars climbing there, and that's that one hertz spike area. And I'm out of the meditation, I'm just talking and I'm engaging the world again. And I'm just telling them how I feel happy. My eyes are glowing. Yeah, and you can see that one hertz get really, really high just by being present in a type of blissfully engaged experience.
I don't know if I mentioned this before when we were doing the recording, but if you look here, this orange line, okay, it's got this relatively smooth sinusoidal type of waveform. That's a really good indicator that you can just look at that waveform and see that someone is in a very pleasant state. And if you're not, so you can regulate that waveform and create it sinusoidal with breathing, like breathing at specific rates, but it also will happen when you're experiencing high level emotions. Mm-hmm. And so that's a pretty neat. So look, for most people, you put them on, they're not trying to do anything yet. You haven't given them a task, breathe this way or start emoting. You'll see a really jagged, it'll look a little bit more like this happening where it's jagged and kind of jiggery like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, it's interesting, Jonathan. So that what you're seeing now is me outside of the meditative experience. Mm. And so when I was in the meditative experience, for the most part, those bars weren't that high. And I was more non-physical. And so my whole physical body for most of the time had very little arousal in it, very little energy I was feeling. But once I come out of the meditation, automatically all this arousal starts in that heart coherent system. So it's potential that I was more in a non-physical state, integrating something that the physical machinery wasn't showing. And then as I re-engage my consciousness in the physical machinery, in the physical body plugs into that energy current I was in, and now the physical body displays it.
And there's, it's, and it is more than just current, there's a quality to it. So when you're coming back, there's high valence to the quality. There's high positive emotion that's coming along.
Yeah,
with that.
Yeah. Because when I'm in that non-physical state, I'm feeling the energy of happiness and peace, but it's very disconnected from any meaning in the physical world because I'm not really perceiving the physical world. I lose a lot of awareness of my body. So I'm maybe in like deep meditation, I might be 95% non-physical and 5% physical. Mm. In a typical meditation, maybe it's like 20, 80, 20 or 85, 15 or 90, 10. Just to throw out a number. Like when I channel, sometimes all I'm aware of is my mouth and that's it. That's all I can feel in my body. And I don't notice anything else until like a loud sound appears in my environment. It feels like it goes through me. It feels like I'm the space and this sound vibration just filled me up. So sound is very disruptive when I'm in that meditative state or when I'm in a channeling state, because I am so vibrationally aligned to this very subtle feeling. Mm-hmm. It's like if you're trying to listen to very soft music and you have to turn up the volume really high to get there. And then a loud sound happens through the music player and it's like totally blasts your ears off. So that's kind of like how it is when there's loud physical sounds when I'm in the channeling state. Now, when I'm in the meditative state, it's different. When I'm in the meditative state, loud sounds don't even disturb me. I don't flinch. I don't move. I don't register them psychologically because there's a different part of my network turned on when I'm in a channeling experience because I'm still processing through the mind. And so I'm still very receptive to a sensory perception, even though it's non-physical sensory perception.
Yeah, talk a little bit, if you can, about, you mentioned to me before that you are fed, you're fueled by the channeling experience, yeah, where most channels are not.
Yeah. So when I'm channeling, my hunger will go away. If I'm hungry before I start channeling, it'll just go away. And I'll have energy levels the whole time. I don't fall asleep. I don't get tired while I'm channeling. I don't get tired after I'm channeling. I feel energized. I'm very happy to interact with. I'm very in love with life. I'm just feeling this overflow of joy. My eyes feel like they're shining with light. So when I channel, I plug into something and then it flows into my physical reality while the channeling happens, but also after it. And a lot of other channels, they report feeling tired, their physical body's exhausted. Some channels take certain minerals for the heart, like potassium or magnesium or calcium, because they notice their heart muscles affected by their channeling experience. For me, I've never had any of those things. I've actually had the opposite. I think my health has improved. In fact, I know it has. If I'm having any sort of emotional disturbance or even like a physical disturbance, like being tired or hunger, like it goes away in about 10, 20 seconds of being in that higher self connection. So like if I just had stress for some reason, like maybe I'm late for my appointment, I'm rushing to get home, my body's real energized and I'm feeling stress. As soon as I start meditating or as soon as I start channeling, I sink into it, it immediately just starts to evaporate. And then it's gone like it never happened and it doesn't come back afterwards. So I've seen that in so many different ways. You know, anything human, any human emotion, it can't come into that channel. The channel purifies it from my own physical vehicle.
We were speculating, or you were speculating, that maybe the reason why other channels get so fatigued in this process is there is a pretty large differential between their body's energy state and what they're channeling.
Yeah.
So there's effort involved in bridging that gap.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And your physical body is conditioned to your personality. So I've conditioned my own self through these spiritual practices and all these lifestyle choices to really raise my human vibration to the highest level I could. And it's always an ongoing experience. I feel that this is always going to be part of our human journey, you know, maintain health and happiness and peace and knowledge. So for myself, I'm connecting into something that's a greater part of me. So there's more of a compatibility. I've done my own inner work to raise my vibration. So there's less of a difference between the higher part of myself I channel and my human part. And the more I've been channeling, the more I am transformed. So for those people who've been watching my videos or know me personally for a number of years, you've seen my personality change dramatically in this length of time, like in a way that's just, I haven't observed anyone else. I'm an incredibly different personality than I've been before. And the people who know me personally, they've all seen that. My videos show that. Not always do people grow that fast, I feel. Because I spend basically every day connecting to the higher self in the work that I do, I'm immersing myself in this higher part of me, and it's constantly streaming down into this human self and evolving it.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
All right, so I want to jump to looking at one more video, going back to our consultation with Jay. And I talked a bit about gamma before, and I suspected that we would see gamma in your brain, especially when you were feeling these high valence emotions, because that's what's seen in experienced loving kindness meditators. So what Jay, when we mentioned this, he said, there's a way to look at, to analyze the data that we weren't doing before. We just didn't know that it existed, right? And so what he did right here, and you can see it, is show this peak that arises right here. This is a gamma spike that's happening for you. And this is 54 hertz. A lot of times in the literature, you see 40 hertz. So this is faster. I don't know what that means, but it's in the gamma range. And what's also significant about this is that you weren't having your peak experience, because this is our third recording. when you needed to hold still. Maybe you can talk about that.
So in the first meditation that we did, the first brain scan, I really wasn't given any instruction. I was just loaded up with the cap and all the different sensors on my body parts. And I was told, just do what comes naturally, just do your thing, Lincoln. And so my body was moving, my head was spinning around because I surrendered to this higher self experience, and this strong non-physical energy starts to move through all my channels. And so if you watch the videos, I have different Kundalini experiences. I have what I call the higher self energy descending into you. So it feels like a corkscrew spiral coming down from the top of your head, making its way all the way down to your root chakra. My spiritual heart radiates. I have all these different experiences, and it's moving my body and moving my head. What I didn't know is that whenever you move the muscles of your scalp, it registers on the brain sensors, and that can create all sorts of static that makes it a little more challenging to get the best data. So we had a lot of this activity in the brain or in the scalp, which we were able to remove using the software, because the, you know, many scientists have run into this issue before. But then the third time we did the brain stuff, I was told, like, don't move, just like try to be still, try to like not clench your jaw, try to not blink your eyes, like really try to be as immobile as possible while you're in these states. So my mind was in this state of trying to be aware of my body, and I couldn't completely let go into the non-physical experience because I would start moving, I would start spinning, different things would happen. Also, my mind was more conscious of trying to perform a certain way rather than just surrendering. So I was trying to keep my body still. I was trying to be aware of my mouth, to not blink my eyes. And I think that just brought maybe some beta online or some alpha online, because it was more of a feeling of a personal self. But the one thing that Jonathan noticed when we compared the first brain reading to the third brain reading was that the waveforms were very similar. A lot of the things that showed up were similar, but just the amplitude, the strength of them had been reduced.
Yeah, so I think if we were, we were seeing a lot of artifact. Artifact is when you're moving your head, when you're moving the muscles in your scalp. And what I didn't know at the time was that the frequencies that your muscles are basically emitting overlap in the gamma range. Mm-hmm. So it's very possible that in that first recording, what we were seeing were gamma bursts and not actually muscle movements.
And one thing that Dr. Jay said was, there are certain electrodes that don't exhibit any muscular movement. And so he focused on those to identify the gamma bursts, because he said the muscle doesn't move here. So you can get a very accurate reading of the brain. And so he was able to identify gamma bursts more easily in those particular spots of the brain.
Yeah. There's another location, O2, which is in the back. I'll hit play here and it should pop up. There we go. Down here at O2, he's going to scroll down here in a moment, but you'll see a pretty big gamma spike in that area as well.
Yeah. And so that doesn't register movement of the skull or the skin of the skull, the scalp. So it showed a real accurate reading.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, I think we got a lot of it covered.
We definitely got a lot covered. And I mean, we have so much more that we're going to be sharing in future videos for everyone. Because we can look at, it happened when I was doing third eye readings. I presented some videos where I was looking into non-physical reality, and that appeared differently in the brain than when I was looking at a physical location like remote viewing. There's so much data here. It really takes hours to look into it and to run these different types of computer analyses to really draw out the results so we can understand more accurately what's happening. And we'll present it to you as we put it all together. And it's a lot of fun for us. I mean, I'm looking forward to getting the brain cap on again.
Oh, good. Good, because we want you to.
Yeah, it's fun stuff. Yeah.
So thank you. Thank you to Lincoln. Thank you to Mark. Thank you to Alex and Jay for being on the team and getting this all together. And thanks for tuning in, checking out this video.
Yeah, we appreciate you guys. And we hope that everything we shared offers you some new knowledge, some new experience, and most importantly, some encouragement. Right. I often like to say that anything that you can witness in someone else is an inspiration for something that you can experience for yourself. So look upon all this as inspiration to what happens when you also apply your own spiritual teachings and you cultivate yourself in a greater way. And like for me, maybe one day, you know, after 20 years of practice, somebody will show up and say, hey, I want to measure your brain. And you actually get to see what's been happening inside of yourself the whole time without even knowing it. So it's a pretty cool experience. So thank you, Jonathan. Yeah, thank you, Mark and Alex and Jay. I appreciate this opportunity and look forward to sharing more information and working with you guys some more.